All right, let's do this one last time.
You're a bit late.
We can't all be everywhere at once.
A little text might have been nice.
I was gone for less than 2 hours. What happened?
Okay. I know what it looks like, but here's the good news.
Oh, here we go.
The multiverse didn't collapse.
Oh, cool.
A little touch and go. It worked out.
Great story. Hey, did you finish the goober?
It's not a goober, it's a gizmo.
You always have to call me out. It's just really frustrating and bugs me.
Don't get too excited, Miguel. It's just a prototype.
Not excited.
But you could be the first person to make an autonomous multiverse jump. Or the last.
Okay, so we're just gonna roll the dice on this?
So what do you say, pal? Where do you wanna go first?
Let's start at the beginning, one last time. Earth 67.
Welcome back, everyone. It's Charlie. Sony just dropped the Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse 2 teaser, and we already know a whole bunch about the movie, so we'll break it down. I do Easter egg videos every week. If you're brand new to my channel, be sure to subscribe to get everything. I will think of some fun Spider-Verse giveaway to do in all my Spider-Man videos, because there is a lot of Spider-Man-related movie stuff happening in the next 2 years. But right after the first movie came out and was a huge critical and financial success, we all knew that they were working on a sequel. Even the producers were talking about it. The reason why they're only just releasing this now is because after the first one came out, all the people that worked on the first one, which is amazing, needed a short break, and they needed to figure out what the story of the sequel would be and figure out how long it would take to make it so they could pick a release date, which wound up being April 8th, 2022. The first one came out December 2018, so if you're wondering why it's taking them almost 4 years to make the sequel, it's because that's about how long it took them to make the first film. It took a long time. Also, some Easter eggs from that teaser. When they're glitching between the different Spider-Man versions and the different logos, they flash the logo from the 1978 Japanese Spider-Man TV series, implying he'll play some role or cameo during the movie at some point, and they flash the logo from the 1990s animated Spider-Man TV show, implying that they'll incorporate some elements from that, too. This could also be representative of Jessica Drew's symbol, and this one could also be Ben Reilly. There's also some theories that this one represents Mr. Negative, because he's a really big character they used in the Spider-Man PS4 games, longtime comic book Spider-Man villain. Would make sense they would try to include him in the Spider-Verse movies at some point. There are also a lot of people that are wondering if this might represent Carnage or some sort of twist on the Venom symbiote, but I don't think that they would do Carnage before they do Venom. We already know a little bit about the basic plot and the characters in the ending scene from the first movie in that last Spider-Man 2099 post-credit scene are really big teasers and Easter eggs for how the sequel will work. They kind of already told you how they're going to accomplish that, because the whole premise of the first movie is that Kingpin uses a machine to crack open the multiverse, or the Spider-Verse, as you call it in the Spider-Man comics. There's even webs connecting the different dimensions in the background where they're all falling through to Miles' Earth from the Ultimate Spider-Man comics. So they really are literally doing Spider-Verse. They destroy that machine at the end of the movie, Kingpin is in jail, and most of the Sinister Six and other major Spider-Man villains have been neutralized or aren't smart enough to reconstruct that multiverse device. So you ask, how do they bring back the characters from the first movie for another team-up on Miles' Earth and any new characters that they want to add to the team? So here's the thing, they already answered that question with the ending scene where after the events of the main movie, there's a short time jump, and Spider-Gwen opens a portal above Miles' head to just chat him up from her universe. And if it wasn't clear, that is supposed to be happening in a relatively short amount of time after they all go back to their universes at the end of the movie. So she really is Skyping him from her universe. Then they explained how she did that in the Spider-Man 2099 post-credit scene. Miguel O'Hara, Spider-Man 2099, played by Oscar Isaac himself, if you didn't recognize his voice, constructs a futuristic goober based on the webware wrist devices from the Spider-Verse comics that allows him to travel the multiverse or the Spider-Verse at free will. And he can do it with precision. He can set exactly where in time and space he wants to go. He goes back in time to the very first Spider-Man 1960s animated TV show to recreate that pointing gif.
Whoa.
What the?
I'm Spider-Man. I need you to come with me.
Who the heck are you?
I just told you that. Listen, I'm from the future.
How dare you point at me?
You were pointing first.
Rude to point.
You're being very rude. You're not even believing what
Which
I'm saying.
Which one pointed first?
As awesome as that was, they were also using that post-credit scene to sort of set up the logic of how the sequel can work. Those devices are straight out of the Spider-Verse comics, and Jessica Drew, Spider-Woman, uses them to assemble a team of Spider-Man versions from alternate universes to go on missions across the Spider-Verse. So at some point after the events of the main story of the movie, they all go home. Spider-Gwen must have been given one of those devices by Spider-Man 2099, implying that he would have a bigger role in the sequel and there would be a bigger time travel element in the story. They already used time travel in the first movie, if that wasn't clear. So Spider-Man Noir, played by Nicolas Cage, was hilarious, but he actually comes from Depression 1930s era. Then Penny Parker with her Evangelion mech come from the distant future, even further in the future from Miguel O'Hara's Spider-Man 2099. So they were already time traveling in that movie, so it's no big deal to have people from other points in time and other universes show up in present day on Miles' Earth. Right now for the sequel, the only confirmed characters we know are coming back are Hailee Steinfeld's Spider-Gwen, because they're developing a spin-off movie for her, and then Miles, of course. Maybe Jake Johnson's Peter B. Parker, just because he was so amazing. Part of his arc at the end of the film, too, was them implying that he finally wanted children and reconciled with his version of Mary Jane on his Earth, and they would go on to have a daughter, Mayday Parker, from the Spider-Man comics. If you're not a big reader of the Spider-Man comics, there is a comic where she grows up to succeed him as Spider-Man, taking the name Spider-Girl. Because time travel is already a really common thing in these movies, they can use time travel to explain how an older or maybe a young version of Peter's daughter can join the franchise. But here's the thing about the story and escalation. The whole concept of these Spider-Verse movies is that they're doing a version of the Spider-Verse comics. Eventually, once they introduce the concept of the multiverse and the web of life and destiny, they reveal that there's a bigger multiverse-level villain that's trying to destroy or consume different Spider-People called Mor-Lun. That doesn't mean that Mor-Lun is going to be the villain of the sequel, but part of the idea with these animated movies is that you can do any story you want. Budget isn't a factor in terms of scope like it is for live-action movies. They can go as big as they want. And what is the natural escalation of the Spider-Verse comics? It's a story called Spider-Geddon, which is just an even bigger crossover. That's sort of the Spider-Verse comics version of Avengers Infinity War and Avengers Endgame. And because the first movie was such a big hit for them, they also confirmed that they're developing all these spin-off movies and additional sequels in a bunch of live-action Spider-Verse TV shows. Really cool inside baseball Easter egg from the first movie, too. Originally, they talked about including live-action elements as part of the many different versions of Spider-Man that appear during the movie. Tom Holland also revealed recently that they originally planned to have him cameo as his MCU Spider-Man in the movie, and Lord and Miller, the producers, also said they discussed about bringing back Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield as their versions of Spider-Man. So there is no limit to the level of craziness that they will eventually get to. And yes, once Tom Holland, Tobey, and Andrew Garfield cameo as their Spider-Man versions, that effectively canonizes their movies to this larger Spider-Verse that they're creating with the animated movies. That's also kind of the idea of how you can explain MCU Spider-Man hopping between the MCU movies and the Venom movies, or that Tobey's Spider-Man exists in an alternate universe. Even Peter B. Parker was created to be an amalgam of all the previous versions of Spider-Man in the movies. Like when he's telling his backstory, a lot of the scenes that they show are scenes from Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man movies. The only totally new concept that I believe that they'll introduce in the sequel is the concept of Venom, because we didn't really get into any symbiotes or anything like that during the first Spider-Verse movie. But if they talked about including Tom Holland as his version of Spider-Man in these movies, then I think that they would also try to get Tom Hardy to cameo as his version of Venom in the animated Spider-Verse movies at some point. Everyone, post all your theories for Spider-Verse 2 in the comments, and I will do more Spider-Man and Venom 2 videos soon, but everybody click here.